Hello everyone, I am Be Better Gamer. Welcome to my YouTube channel, your place for WWF No Mercy, Virtual Pro Wrestling 2, WCW nWo Revenge Let's Plays. Sometimes I sprinkle in a little WrestleMania 2000 or WrestleMania, or I should say WWE 2K15 or various other wrestling games, but the primary focus are those three legendary AKI developed wrestling games. Today I will be playing Revenge, going after the current Cruiserweight champion, Chris Jericho, and I will be playing as Eddie Guerrero. Now, I'm actually doing something a little special today. This is the playthrough footage that I have already on my channel of Eddie Guerrero going through the Cruiserweight division, and I am just putting commentary over it. When I first started uploading videos to YouTube, I was just uploading playthroughs of WCW nWo Revenge. No commentary, I didn't have a mic like I do now. I have the Blue Snowball mic. But I just wanted to play stuff and test out my Elgato that I had purchased at the time and just put footage up, because at the time when I first started doing it, I didn't really have the means to do commentary. When I started doing commentary, I actually started with WWF No Mercy, started with the Light Heavyweight Championship, did all that, then I did the European Championship. So I only recently have begun to do some Virtual Pro Wrestling 2 videos and WCW NWO Revenge videos, and the few WCW NWO Revenge videos I have already done, there's four of them. I did Macho Man, Scott Steiner, Sting, and Ultimo Dragon. I hadn't yet done playthroughs of them, with the exception of Ultimo Dragon, but I did a Cruiserweight run, and then I did a commentary of my TV title run. So instead of going back and re-recording, you know, new gameplay playthroughs, as much as I love these games and as much as I would enjoy doing that, it would take a lot of time, and I'm already kind of inconsistent about uploading videos to my channel. So in order to not further delay how long you have to wait between my new videos and episodes, I decided to just take all my existing WCW nWo Revenge playthroughs and do commentary for the ones that, you know, I want to do. So we're starting with Eddie Guerrero today. Again, this is already the playthrough of that I had already on my channel. I'm just adding commentary on top of it. But if you're just joining me, basically what I like to do for these Let's Plays is I like to talk about the game, obviously, talk about the mechanics, the design, how lovely and wonderful these games are, and how there's still no other wrestling game that I feel personally can top the engine of these games. But I also like to talk about sort of like the historical context of what was going on around the time when these games were being developed. It's very interesting for me because I get to go back and, you know, do research and look at the wrestling I grew up with, and at the same time look at it through another lens, look at it through the lens of maybe what the design choices of the game were and how they might have been influenced by what was going on in wrestling at the time, and also be able to look back and reflect and just see how far we've come, not only in video games but in wrestling. It's just a great way for me to blend two passions I have. So WCW nWo Revenge was released in October of 98. This was not the first AKI wrestling game obviously developed. It was WCW nWo World Tour, which was released in November 97. And that was developed simultaneously along Virtual Pro Wrestling 64, which was only released in Japan in December of 97, I should say. So I'm going to be talking about basically November of 97 until October of 1998. Eddie Guerrero is one of my favorite wrestlers of all time. He has a very storied career. He did a lot in Mexico. He did a lot in Japan. He did a lot in WCW and WWE, WWF, ECW. He's been everywhere. He's all over the map. WWE Hall of Famer. I mean, if you don't know who Eddie Guerrero is, then you probably just started watching wrestling, because unfortunately he is no longer with us. He passed away about almost a decade ago. But his legacy still stands to today, and his time in WCW was very interesting. He was brought in from ECW. I mean, he was wrestling in Mexico and Japan for a very long time, and then he was wrestling in ECW briefly. And then Eric Bischoff brought him, brought Dean Malenko, brought Conan, and a few at Rey Mysterio, Psychosis, a bunch of guys he pretty much picked up from ECW and brought them into WCW and formed the foundation of this new, great, exciting form of wrestling that these guys were introducing. Eddie Guerrero was part of that movement. The only thing is that there was a very low glass ceiling in WCW, and Eddie Guerrero and all these guys never really got to rise above it. So this is a great year to talk about that, because he gained a lot of success as a wrestler, as a personality. If you go back and you watch his WCW stuff, he was so over. He was over as a babyface. They loved him. And then when he turned heel, people loved to boo him. But no one could deny his talent. He was so good in the ring. And hopefully my matches reflect that. You know, I'm going up against Psychosis right now. And Psychosis was considered a cruiserweight. And I am going for the cruiserweight championship. But Eddie Guerrero, actually, the first title he ever held in WCW was the U.S. Heavyweight Championship. He defeated Diamond Dallas Page in a tournament final in December 29th, 1996 at Starrcade. So if you got the WWE Network, Starrcade 96. I guess going forward, damn, I almost won with the Frog Splash right there. The Frog Splash, he always put people away with the Frog Splash, even back in WCW. And that right there, his front special, is actually the Black Tiger Bomb. Because when he wrestled in Japan, he wrestled under a mask called Black Tiger 2. He was a second incarnation of Black Tiger. Black Tiger was basically the antagonist to Tiger Mask. If you don't know who Tiger Mask is, real quick, he was basically like an anime character brought to life in wrestling. The first Tiger Mask was Satoru Sayama. I hope I'm pronouncing that right. It's been a long time since I've had to say that. That was the first Tiger Mask. Feuded with Dynamite Kid. The second Tiger Mask was Mitsuhiro Misawa. You know, and he took off the mask. It was a big thing. And so Eddie Guerrero was the second Black Tiger. Black Tiger in the anime was the antithesis to Tiger Mask. I forget who the first Black Tiger was. It was another American wrestler. And the Black Tiger was, for a little bit, was always portrayed by a gaijin, basically a non-Japanese wrestler. Because in Japan, you know, they considered Americans the heels for a very long time. Obviously because of the effects of World War II, the bombing of Hiroshima. So people, you know, Japanese didn't really have a high... I should say respect for Americans for a very long time, and some of that sentiment still carries on today with a lot of the older Japanese. But fortunately, we've kind of like mended fences, and our relationship is a lot better. But if you were an American, or actually just not even American, a non-Japanese, you would call it gaijin, and you were usually a heel. So Eddie Guerrero was a heel in Japan, but he wrestled in the mask, Black Tiger. So a lot of people always ask me, why does Eddie Guerrero do that as his front special? I've rarely ever seen him do that. And he rarely did do that. In WCW, if you watch a lot of his matches, there were very few moments when he went for the Black Tiger Bomb. I think, if anything, the most memorable Black Tiger Bomb he ever tried to attempt was against Rey Mysterio Jr. at their Halloween Havoc 1997 match, which I'll get into later on, where he went to go for it from the top rope, and Rey Mysterio countered it into a Hurricanrana, and it was mind-blowing. Classic Rey Mysterio. But so Eddie Guerrero, U.S. Heavyweight Champion, but we're not going to talk about his championship reign as the U.S. Heavyweight title holder. We're going to focus on the cruiserweight, but I do have to say real quick before we get into the cruiserweight stuff, his first match on Nitro, if you don't already know, was against Dean Malenko on October 2nd, 1995. It's on the WWE Network. The WWE Network has all the 95 and 96 Nitros. If you have the WWE Network, basically if you hear me mention a WCW pay-per-view, you can go watch it. And any Nitro from 95 to 96, you can watch it as well. So if you want to watch these Eddie Guerrero matches, and I highly recommend you do, and I'll probably reinforce that when I get to some of these matches, I'll say, yeah, you definitely should go watch these matches. Just go onto the WWE Network and watch it. If you don't have it, I really highly suggest any wrestling fan get the WWE Network. It's a great resource. It's fascinating to go back and watch some of these guys. Even if you know you watched it when you were a kid, to go back and watch it as an adult, I feel like you watch it through a whole nother lens. You have a different appreciation for it, and you might notice stuff that you never noticed when you were younger. I know I've been learning a lot. even as much as I know about wrestling and how long I've been following wrestling, I still feel like I learn something new every day. I watch a match I've never seen before on the network. It's great. It's fantastic. Get New Japan World also while you're at it. I tried to see if New Japan World had some Black Tiger 2 stuff, but they don't. But I did see some Pegasus Kid stuff on there, so I'm very excited to be watching some Pegasus Kid. And I mentioned Pegasus Kid because Eddie Guerrero's second match on WCW Nitro was on October 16th, and he faced Dean Malenko. Chris Benoit. He faced Dean Malenko in his first match. So some foreshadowing there, if you will, if you've been a fan of WWE during the late Attitude Era, when you saw the Radicals come in, when you saw Eddie Guerrero, Chris Benoit, and Dean Malenko come in as a unit, along with Perry Saturn, it goes back even to their first appearance on Nitro, Dean Malenko and Eddie Guerrero going against each other, and then in Eddie Guerrero's second match, he faces Chris Benoit, who Chris Benoit was making his debut on WCW Nitro also at the same time. He was called Chris Benoit, but he was coming over from ECW as Chris Benoit. But in Japan, Chris Benoit wrestled as the Wild Pegasus. So, little cool fun fact there that I didn't really realize. I always knew that Eddie Guerrero and Dean Malenko fought on that episode of Nitro, but I kind of forgot that just 2 weeks later we got Chris Benoit. So very cool, very exciting stuff. Go watch the Chris Benoit Eddie Guerrero match and the Dean Malenko match too. The Dean Malenko match gets kind of interrupted by their stupid storyline with Hogan and stuff like that. Like, they actually cut to a promo of Hogan coming in a limo during the match. It's very stupid. But the Eddie Guerrero match, Chris Benoit match, you got Mike Tenay calling the bout, along with Tony Schiavone and I think Mongo McMichael, and it's not Tony Schiavone, I think it was Eric Bischoff, and fantastic match between Eddie Guerrero and Chris Benoit. I'm facing Kidman right now, and if you've ever owned this game, you know that in order to unlock Kidman, he was the Cruiserweight champion holder in the game. So in order to get Kidman, you have to do the Cruiserweight championship and you unlock him at the end of it. Kidman in his Flock gimmick, and very interesting, the Flock had disbanded by the time WCW NWO Revenge was released, but I guess it was way too late to take him out because I think they disbanded like literally like that month or the month before, and by that time Billy Kidman had abandoned his heroin gimmick, where he was always, you know, he was supposed to be like this junkie user, missing the frog splash. Oh man, I try to go for the frog splash a lot. I try to win with the frog splash. It's very hard in WCW NWO Revenge to keep people down on the mat for a long time. So you gotta kind of take your opportunity when you can, and hopefully they won't counter it. I am playing on the hard difficulty. I don't know if that really matters in terms of them staying down on the mat longer or not. Maybe they get up faster because of that. So I'll try to win with the frog splash as much as I can, but you know, you'll probably usually see me win with the Black Tiger Bomb or his back special, which is like a suplex pin or something like that, if I remember correctly. So Kidman was actually the Cruiserweight champion when WCW NWO Revenge was released. But a little history about the Cruiserweight title before we get into Eddie Guerrero's reigns as the champion. Here comes Ultimo Dragon interfering. So WCW actually had the Light Heavyweight Championship. Back in 1991, it was won by Brian Pillman. You guys might know who he is if you watched, you know, WWF, if you never seen him in WCW. But Brian Pillman beat Ricky Morton, Halloween Havoc 91, and at a tournament final, and he was the WCW Light Heavyweight Champion. Now, the title would be vacated in September of 92 because the champion at the time, Brad Armstrong, got a legitimate knee injury, so they vacated the title, and they were like, yeah, we're going to do a tournament. They never did the tournament to decide who the new champion was. Flash forward, 1996, there was a bunch of matches being held off TV for some reason, and also in Japan to decide who was going to be the WCW Cruiserweight champion. And what ended up happening was Wild Pegasus, aka Chris Benoit, and this was before he was actually signed to WCW, he was wrestling in Japan, took on Shinjiro Otani, who had a working relationship with WCW at the time, in Japan for the Cruiserweight Championship at the end of the tournament final. And Shinjiro Otani was actually the first Cruiserweight champion. If you don't know who Shinjiro Otani is, that's perfectly understandable. His time in WCW was very brief. But I will be doing some stuff on Shinjiro Otani because he is in virtual pro wrestling too. And he is one of the top... At this time, or actually maybe a few years later, he becomes one of the top junior heavyweights in Japan, especially New Japan Pro Wrestling. So definitely a lot of stuff to talk about Otani, but this is Guerrero in the WCW, so let's talk about that. So his first and only title defense would be against Dean Malenko. All right, this is Otani at Worldwide on March 20th, 1996, on May 18th, 1996. So, you know, a little over a month later, he defends the title on WCW TV against Dean Malenko on an episode of Worldwide. Dean Malenko wins. All right, so that's basically the history, the first title reign and title defense of the Cruiserweight Championship. Now, Eddie Guerrero was not yet in the company at this time. And when you play this game, it's really cool because you can't just choose anyone to be the Cruiserweight Championship holder. In WWF No Mercy, when you do the Light Heavyweight Championship, even though the rules, the weight limit is supposed to be, you know, 220 pounds or whatever, WWF No Mercy doesn't really prevent you from choosing anyone to be the Light Heavyweight Champion. So you can actually play as Andre the Giant and go for the Light Heavyweight Championship in WWF No Mercy. But in this game, you can only choose the Cruiserweights to be in the, you know, championship path. And there's 13 Cruiserweights in the game. It's Chris Benoit, Chris Jericho, Eddie Guerrero, Psychosis, Disco Inferno, Rey Mysterio Jr., Juventud Guerrera, Ultimo Dragon, Chavo Guerrero Jr., Alex Wright, Lodi, La Parka, and Kidman. And you'll only face Cruiserweights. So that's you know, you're pretty much facing almost all the Cruiserweights every time you do this path. And really interesting, every single Cruiserweight that I named, only two of them didn't hold the Cruiserweight title in their time in WCW, and that was Lodi and La Parka. Lodi and La Parka, unfortunately for La Parka, the chairman of the board, never were Cruiserweight champions. Another interesting thing I like to point out was that Six, who everyone probably knows as X-Pac, if you don't remember him as being Six in WCW, he was in WCW versus NWO World Tour. But he wasn't, and in Virtual Pro Wrestling 64, but he wasn't in WCW NW Revenge. This is because of a contract thing. He was actually fired towards the beginning of the year and then would show up in WWF like a week later. So he was a Cruiserweight champion and one of the, you know, notable Cruiserweight champions too. But he doesn't make an appearance in this game, but he does come back in WrestleMania 2000. And in No Mercy. So he almost made it to every single AKI developed wrestling game. I think that's pretty interesting to point out, because Eddie Guerrero and Six had a brief feud, but it was actually over the US heavyweight title, I believe. So what else? Real quick before I get to Eddie Guerrero, a few other Cruiserweight facts for people who maybe never watched the Cruiserweight division. Shane Helms was the last Cruiserweight champion when WCW was purchased by WWF. You know, Hurricane Helms, Gregory Helms. Rey Mysterio Jr. had the most title reigns in WCW with 5. Jericho and Malenko were tied for second with 4. Six, aka X-Pac, had the longest individual reign, meaning his, you know, the longest amount of days for one reign, holding it for 125 days. In his first and only reign as Cruiserweight champion. Rey Mysterio Jr. had the second, holding it for 115 days in his final reign, his fifth reign. And Jericho and Kidman tied for third with 113 days with their third and second reigns, respectively. So those are some quick WCW Cruiserweight Championship facts. And I think it's important to share that and bring that up, because when WCW was purchased by WWE, they didn't really make an effort to, continue the lineage and history of the WCW Cruiserweight. I think if you ask any fan of wrestling at that time, you know, anyone who grew up watching Nitro and WWF, everyone will say that they loved watching the Cruiserweight division. They loved watching guys like Eddie Guerrero and Rey Mysterio Jr. and Dean Malenko and Ultimo Dragon. Like, everyone has fond memories of... And if you look back and if you watch the matches, again, you can see why. The stuff they did at the time was very innovative. No one else was doing it. And people to this day still try to emulate that style. If anything... I mean, it's still taking a long time to for us to get to that point, but their style of high-flying and technical wrestling that they brought with them from Japan, from Mexico, to this Cruiserweight division is basically what set the standard for a lot of the younger guys that are wrestling today. When you see guys like nWo, when you see guys like Sami Zayn, even to a certain extent, guys like Cesaro, who are power-based, they still incorporate a lot of technical and even sometimes high-flying stuff because that's what these guys innovated. And especially when you look at the heights that guys like Chris Jericho and Eddie Guerrero reached, becoming multiple-time world champions in WWE, they broke the mold. They broke the, you know, you gotta be 6'6", you gotta be like a Hulk Hogan type or Ultimate Warrior type in order to make it to the top. And they broke the mold because their stuff was exciting. I mean, it wasn't strange to be seeing them doing hurricanranas in every match and high-flying maneuvers. But at the same time, they were also great mat technicians and great chain wrestlers. And Eddie Guerrero was probably one of my favorites out of everyone. And I was so happy to see him rise to the level of success that he did in WWE. Because I feel like out of all the Cruiserweights... Even though I never really considered him a Cruiserweight, but because of his size, you know, WCW did, and he was Cruiserweight champion twice. I felt like he had the most personality, along with Jericho. Him and Jericho, I felt, had the most personality. You know, Rey Mysterio Jr. was fantastic and great to watch, but, you know, he didn't really talk on the mic much. Part of the mystique was his mask. When he lost his mask, he lost a little bit of that mystique in WCW. So it was great that he brought the mask back with him in WWE. But even like Ultimo Dragon, who's probably one of my favorite wrestlers, you know, I don't watch Ultimo Dragon for his promos, for his personality, but Eddie Guerrero is kind of like the total package. You know, he really is. Sorry, Lex Luger, but Eddie Guerrero is the total package. He had everything you wanted in a wrestler. He could be a great babyface. He could be a great heel. And you can see that even in WCW. And when you hear about him talking, or when he used to talk about his time in WCW, he was very frustrated. WWE has a really good series of episodes called The Monday Night War on the WWE Network, and there's a lot of talk about Eddie Guerrero in one particular episode called The Flight of the Cruiserweights, where they talk about the Cruiserweight division, and they talk about the legacy that it created, and they talk about Eddie Guerrero and how he and Benoit and Dean Malenko felt like they were getting pigeonholed to be these smaller guys, and they weren't getting pushed, even though they were getting some of the biggest reactions of the night. And people love them. And you can definitely see that. You can see that if you go back and watch any of these matches I'm about to talk about. You can see how over and excited the fans were with Eddie Guerrero. Here comes La Parka, chairman of the board. Unfortunately, never held the Cruiserweight Championship. I'm sorry, La Parka. Play your chair. What's really funny is that he doesn't walk to the ring with the chair. But he's going to start the match with the chair. This is something that... the WWE games didn't do. They didn't let the wrestlers bring weapons to the ring, which I always thought was funny, because you know you would get that DQ'd right away. But here we go. La Parka is gonna start with the chair, and boom, right away it's gone. Shoulder block. It's down. It's gone. You can bring in WWF No Mercy. You can walk to the ring with a weapon, but I don't believe you start the match with the weapon. I could be wrong. You know, I have to double check that, but. That's from what I remember. Eddie Guerrero going to work on La Parka. So yeah, so let's talk about Eddie Guerrero. I talked about the Cruiserweight history a little bit. I talked about some other Eddie Guerrero facts, his first match. But let's talk about Eddie Guerrero and being the Cruiserweight champion. So his first reign as Cruiserweight champion was in Fall Brawl of 97. So pretty close to when, you know, after WCW NWO World Tour was released. It was released in November of 97, so pretty much the same month So that's great. We're basically starting at the right moment. I think going forward, when I do my WCW NW Revenge episodes, I want to focus first on the champions of that year. So that's another reason why I'm starting as Eddie Guerrero, because I just did a Chris Jericho IC Championship, so I didn't want to do another Chris Jericho Cruiserweight video right away. I will. I'll probably do that one next. But Eddie Guerrero won the title Fall Brawl 97. WCW vs. NWO World Tour was just released, so that's giving us a little bit of the context. And he held the title 42 days. And I should say also that he was in WCW vs. NWO World Tour. He was in his babyface gimmick. He had his white pants with the red... with the red designs. Here he has the black pants and the red and gold, and this is when he was more of a heel. So he held the title for 42 days. He defended the title against Dean Malenko at Battle in Seattle, September of 97. And I bring that up because you can't watch that. Not like Eddie Guerrero and Dean Malenko don't fight 1,000 times. I mean, you can watch any Dean Malenko, Eddie Guerrero match. But the interesting thing about this, I never heard of the Battle in Seattle. I thought it was a pay-per-view. And it's actually a house show where they did the live audio commentary for it online on the internet. And this is like, you know, 56 dial-up era internet, okay? But they did it, they and you could go on to whatever website it was and pay to listen to them doing this live commentary. And the play-by-play obviously was done by Mike Tenay, and those audio recordings are missing. You can't listen to them. So I just thought that was very interesting and fascinating, and it just made me reflect on, wow, even in this day and age, when stuff gets put on the internet, it can still be lost. So, very existentialist. Don't worry. Don't mind me. But he would lose the title to Rey Mysterio Jr. at Halloween Havoc 97. So, Eddie Guerrero, from winning the Cruiserweight title, he was embroiled in a feud with Rey Mysterio. They always had beef. They always had beef. And Eddie Guerrero, you know, part of the legendary Guerrero family, the son of Gory Guerrero. Gory Guerrero had four sons: Chavo, Hector, Mondo, and Eddie. Chavo Guerrero Jr. is the son of Chavo Guerrero Sr., Chavo Classic, as some people might know him. But actually, Chavo and Eddie Guerrero are only 2 years apart. So Eddie Guerrero is 2 years older than his nephew. And a lot of history there with the Guerreros and the Mysterios. Their family, you know, they're pretty much family in a way. You know, their two families have been together in wrestling for so long. So they carry that sort of history and lineage between the two families with them to WCW. And Eddie Guerrero, you know, for whatever reason, in WCW on camera, he just wanted to beat up Rey Mysterio. He thought Rey Mysterio was taking all the spotlight from Eddie Guerrero. And Eddie Guerrero was the Cruiserweight champion now, so he didn't want Rey Mysterio taking his spotlight. So that created a feud for the next several months at the beginning of when we're talking about, you know, from November of 97. It was mostly Eddie Guerrero and Rey Mysterio Jr. going back to back. Their first big match meaning because the Cruiserweight title was on the line, was Halloween Havoc 97, and that's actually the Halloween Havoc that's in the game. The arena, I mean, that's Halloween Havoc 97. And it was a mask versus title match, which is a match popularized in Mexico. Basically, one person puts their mask on the line, and in this case, Rey Mysterio Jr., and then the other person puts his title on the line, which is Eddie Guerrero. So, if Eddie Guerrero lost, he'd just lose the championship, but if Rey Mysterio lost, he would lose his mask. He would have to take off his mask. And this is when Rey Mysterio came out in his Phantom outfit. And that is also in WCW NW Revenge. That's one of his outfits. It's probably one of the best matches that Rey Mysterio and Eddie Guerrero ever did. It's probably the most talked about and memorable matches. They've done so many matches over the years, but it still holds up to this day. If you've never seen Halloween Havoc 1997, Rey Mysterio Jr. and Eddie Guerrero, watch that match. And this is another reason why I feel like it was important to do this Eddie Guerrero match, because I did a WWF No Mercy Let's Play video with Eddie Guerrero for the European Championship, and I realized when I was talking to a lot of people about it, not many people were familiar with his work in WCW, and unfortunately, not saying that Eddie Guerrero and Rey Mysterio Jr. were any worse than they were in WCW, they were still fantastic and great wrestlers, but they were definitely, you know, more injured, suffered more injuries in their careers at the time, and, you know, they were a little bit more conservative in how they wrestled. Back then, you know, early WCW, since they were trying so hard to make a name for themselves and establish themselves, they were pulling out all the stops. And this is vintage Rey Mysterio Jr. He didn't wrestle in WWE quite like how he did in WCW, and that was because of due to leg injuries. But if you've never seen Rey Mysterio Jr. in WCW, I think there's no better starting point than Rey Mysterio Jr. versus Eddie Guerrero, Halloween Havoc 97. Eddie Guerrero is a stud in this match. He is a superstar, and it really is a shame that WCW never pushed him, or at least let him wrestle even for the World Heavyweight title. And we'll get into that a little bit later, because it's very interesting, you know, how they kind of denied him those opportunities. But Halloween Havoc 97, Rey Mysterio Jr., Eddie Guerrero, I can't stress it enough. Go watch it on the network. I'm sure you can find it on YouTube or Daily Motion. It is a classic, still holds up, but it would cut Eddie Guerrero's first title reign short. He would lose the title, spoilers, he would lose the title to Rey Mysterio Jr. So his first reign only lasted 42 days with two title defenses, once again, one against Dean Malenko and one against Rey Mysterio, in which he would lose. But don't worry, he would get it back pretty quickly, because he would defeat Rey Mysterio Jr. on an episode of Nitro, which aired on November 10th, 1997. So a couple of weeks after Halloween Havoc, they would have their rematch on Nitro, and Eddie Guerrero would win. He would hold this title for 49 days, but he would actually defend it a little bit more than he did the first time. So this would lead to the rubber match between Eddie Guerrero and Rey Mysterio Jr. at World War III. Not as polished, I would say, as their first match. I think they kind of messed up on a lot of spots they were trying to do, and instead of just trying to do it over again, they just moved on to something else. So it's fine. I mean, that happens. Sometimes matches don't come out the way you want them, but it's still a great match. I recommend watching that one as well. He would take on, but Eddie Guerrero would come out on top this time at World War III, 97. He would defeat Bobby Blaze on an episode of WCW Saturday Night, defending his title. And then he would wrestle against Dean Malenko at Starrcade 97. So here we are, about 2 years later. Dean Malenko and Eddie Guerrero meeting for the first time for the Cruiserweight title. And at Starrcade 97, fantastic match. Go watch that one. Probably one of my favorites, Dean Malenko and Eddie Guerrero matches as well. Starrcade 97, yeah, fantastic, fantastic match. But then the next night, after Starrcade 97, Eddie Guerrero would lose the title to Ultimo Dragon, December 29th. So maybe that's why Ultimo Dragon ran in earlier in one of the earlier matches, setting up that title match for Nitro. But yeah, Eddie Guerrero, there you go, getting the pin over Alex Wright. So yeah, that was basically Eddie Guerrero's title reign. So they're kind of short, but memorable. And I think that's the key thing. That's what's so important about. Sometimes it's not about how long you hold the title, but the impact you make while holding the title. And definitely a lot of these guys, when they held the Cruiserweight title, you can at least look at one or two of their title defenses or matches and say, yeah, that was one of the best matches I've ever seen. And Eddie Guerrero definitely has two of them in my eyes. You know, the one against Rey Mysterio Jr. at Halloween Havoc 97, and the one against Dean Malenko at Starrcade. And his matches with Jericho are really good too. Actually, the first time he ever fought for the Cruiserweight title was in August of 97 at Clash of the Champions 35. That led into the Fall Brawl 97 match. The Fall Brawl match is definitely the better of the two, but the first match is still good. It's a good setup for the Fall Brawl match. But that was the first time Eddie Guerrero ever fought for the Cruiserweight title. So after losing the title to Ultimo Dragon in December 97, Eddie Guerrero would take on Billy Kidman almost a year later at Starrcade 98. Pretty much a year later, right? You know, a year and a day would be the Nitro after. and he would take on Billy Kidman at Starrcade, and he would lose, and that would be the last time he would fight for the Cruiserweight title. So again, his actual time with the Cruiserweight Championship, as memorable as it might be, if you really look at the times he fought for the title and held the title, there weren't a lot of moments. He got the Jericho match and his two title defenses in his first reign. Then you got the Rey Mysterio match and his four title defenses, so that's eight matches as champion and defending it as champion. Then he fought Jericho for the title, so that's nine, and then he took on Kidman for the title, that's 10. So Eddie Guerrero really only had 10 Cruiserweight Championship matches while in WCW. That's mind-blowing to me, because, you know, he was considered, quote-unquote, a Cruiserweight. So what was he doing? What was he doing when he wasn't fighting for the Cruiserweight? He only did it 10 times while he was at WCW. That's not a lot. That's really not a lot for the years that he was there. After he took on Rey Mysterio at Halloween Havoc, and then Rey Mysterio at World War III and Dean Malenko at Starrcade, he wasn't at the sold-out 98 pay-per-view in January. He wasn't at Super Bowl VIII in February. He wasn't injured, because I looked it up. He was on every episode of Nitro Wrestling against other Cruiserweights, against other wrestlers, non-Cruiserweights. He would come back to pay-per-view on Uncensored 98 against Eddie Guerrero, and this was around the time when Chavo Guerrero Jr. was there, and Eddie Guerrero was basically forcing Chavo Guerrero Jr. to do everything he wanted him to do. And, you know, that was his nephew, but he felt like he was going to make his nephew strong and protect his nephew, but he basically beat up Chavo Guerrero whenever Chavo Guerrero wasn't listening, and Chavo Guerrero kind of hated being around Eddie Guerrero, storyline-wise, obviously. But Booker T defended his TV title championship against Eddie Guerrero. Great match between Booker T and Eddie Guerrero. I mean, it goes without saying, mostly every match Eddie Guerrero did, especially on a pay-per-view, was great. But Spring Stampede 98, Eddie Guerrero wasn't there on pay-per-view. Slamboree 98, he would come back. He would take on Ultimo Dragon. Well, actually, he was at Spring Stampede. Spring Stampede, Chavo Guerrero Jr. fought Ultimo Dragon, and Chavo lost. So Eddie Guerrero was like, let me beat Ultimo Dragon. And then there was a stipulation that if Ultimo Dragon had beat Eddie Guerrero, that Chavo would get his freedom. And obviously, Eddie wins, even though Chavo tried to help Ultimo Dragon. After the match, Chavo gets upset at Ultimo, and he starts attacking Ultimo. And this is when Chavo Guerrero starts kind of going crazy. He's a whole crazy gimmick. And that leads into a match at Great American Bash. Chavo Guerrero Jr. against Eddie Guerrero. Now it's kind of turning. Eddie Guerrero's becoming a little bit more than passionate, sympathetic. Oh, what have I done? What have I done to Chavo Guerrero? I've turned him into a monster. So they fight, but Chavo Guerrero actually gets the victory. And then at Bash of the Beach 98, Eddie Guerrero against Chavo Guerrero in a hair versus hair match, another Mexican tradition, or I should say Lucha Libre tradition. They do a lot of these hair versus hair matches. Hair and mask are two symbols of pride in Lucha Libre wrestling. So they did that. Eddie Guerrero beats Chavo Guerrero Jr., so Chavo Guerrero has to shave his head. And instead of Eddie Guerrero shaving his head, Chavo, because he's crazy, shaves his own head. So those are his pay-per-view appearances for the year. If we're talking from November of 97, or October of 97, I should say, to October of 98, from the time WCW World Tour to Revenge, those are his only pay-per-view appearances. He wasn't hurt. He was just not on the pay-per-views for almost half the year. This is a guy who was just, you know, winning the Cruiserweight Championship. A few months before that, he was a U.S. Heavyweight Champion, and then all of a sudden, he's not on the pay-per-view. But he was there every Monday Nitro. If you look at, you know, like the Internet Wrestling Database, they have the listings of all the Nitros, and every single one, Eddie Guerrero was there. He was wrestling. So there definitely is some truth to that statement that he's being held back, because if you watch those matches are great. Those matches are good. He had the personality. People hated him. He was so good at being a heel. He cheated a lot to win, which is something a lot of heels don't do anymore. He argued with the crowd. You hated him when he attacked Chavo Guerrero. Every match he would lose, he was kind of like Kevin Owens. Like, he wouldn't shake your hand. He'd probably beat you up after the match. You know, when he loses against Rey Mysterio Jr. at Halloween Havoc 97, he beats him up. When he loses against Chris Jericho at Clash of the Champions 35, he beats him up. So, he was a jerk. He was so good at being a bad guy. But you couldn't deny how good he was in the ring, because he would get victories, you know, and he would pull out fashionable, you know, not fashionable, spectacular victories, and he was exciting to watch, dynamic to watch. So when you watch these documentaries or old interviews of him talking about him being held back, there's a lot of validity to that statement, because he's not like he's one of those guys, oh, I was being held back, but I was main eventing every pay-per-view. He wasn't around every pay-per-view. But look at these matches. Every pay-per-view he was in, he fought Rey Mysterio again, he fought Dean Malenko, Booker T, Chavo Guerrero. All those matches are great. All those matches are fun. All those matches are exciting. There's no reason why they kind of stopped pushing him after that. So towards the end of the year, what started happening is that Eddie Guerrero started creating this faction called the LWO, which was the Latino World Order. This was right after his feud with Chavo Guerrero. Basically, he wanted to take all the Latin wrestlers and form a unit, a cohesive unit, because he felt that they were all being held back by WCW, by Eric Bischoff, because all the emphasis was on the NWO at the time. And it's true. All the emphasis was on the NWO at the time, and he felt like they were being held back not only because, you know, they were smaller guys, but also maybe because they were Latin, you know, some of them being Mexican or Puerto Rican or Spanish. And I'm sure there's even some validity to that statement. I mean, Eddie Guerrero was one of the few Latin wrestlers to really break out of the mold of being the generic Mexican wrestler. In WWE, I was a little nervous and hesitant when he was doing the whole Latino heat and the mamacita, but you know what? He made it work. He made it positive. He didn't make it a silly stereotype. He made it really just an extension of who he was and himself. He's not like the Los Matadores right now, who are playing two Spanish bullfighters, but they're Puerto Ricans and everyone thinks they're Mexican. So it's like, no, don't do that. That's wrong. You know, and Eddie Guerrero, you know, at WCW at the time, some of these guys were given a little creative freedom only because no one was paying attention. And I guess no one was paying attention when Eddie Guerrero was coming out and doing the LWO and really venting his frustration about, you know, not being involved in the WCW main event. One of the best examples you can see of this is during that Starrcade 98 match. So at Starrcade 98 against Billy Kidman, this was in December of 98. So we've moved on from the historical context, because there's still a lot of stuff I want to talk about with Eddie Guerrero, you know, with the Cruiserweights at the time. So he started the Latino World Order, and basically everyone was gung-ho. Juventud was kind of like his second in command. But he had Psychosis, Silver King, El Dandy, all these guys. And he forced Rey Mysterio Jr. to be a part of it. Rey Mysterio didn't want to be a part of it. He was like, look, I'm Latin, you know, I'm Mexican, but I'm from California, but I kind of want to do my own thing. I don't want to let my nationality define me, and really, you're being kind of a jerk to everyone, so I'm going to stay away from it. And Eddie Guerrero wouldn't have that, and Rey Mysterio was kind of torn, because here he was, he felt like maybe I shouldn't really turn my back on these guys, because they do have a point, and this is my heritage, this is my nationality. You know, in a way they are right, but, you know, I don't maybe like the means they're going about it, but I shouldn't really completely turn my back on them. So Eddie Guerrero wanted the Cruiserweight title to belong to the Latino World Order, and Juventud Guerrera and Rey Mysterio Jr. took on Billy Kidman in a triple threat match at Starrcade. And Billy Kidman ends up winning, even though the LWO tries to interfere, because Rey Mysterio kind of makes it that, you know, Billy Kidman wins the match. So Eddie Guerrero comes out in, like, just regular jeans and a t-shirt, and he's furious. He's furious at Rey Mysterio. He's furious at Juventud Guerrera, starts smacking him around. And he gets on the mic, and he cuts a great, intense promo about the frustration that these guys aren't man enough, they can't do it, and this is why they're being held back, this and that. It's fantastic. It's classic Eddie Guerrero. Eddie Guerrero, that's what I meant when I talked about earlier on in the episode how Eddie Guerrero really was the total package, because he could do it all. He could wrestle, he could talk on the mic, he had personality in the ring, charisma, everything. He could be a good guy, he could be a bad guy. And watch that promo. He cuts it right after the match, and he basically calls out Kidman and says, you know, you're not man enough to come back here and face me because you know I beat you. So Kidman comes out, he's like, oh, I'll face you, all right, let's do it. And Eddie Guerrero's like, all right, well, if you want to wait, I'll go get ready, I'll go put on my tights. Like, classic heel, you know. And then Kidman's like, no, let's go right now. So like, Eddie Guerrero's like, all right, yeah, let's go right now, let's do it. And that's how that match happens. But Eddie Guerrero loses basically because Rey Mysterio prevents Eddie Guerrero and Juventud Guerrera from cheating to win the match. And that snowballs a little bit more into their feud. But unfortunately, what ends up happening in real life, Eddie Guerrero gets involved in a car accident like on New Year's Day of 99. And a very serious car accident. And he gets sidelined for about 5 months or so. So that kind of puts an end to the LWO storyline, because without Eddie Guerrero, there really wasn't anyone else who could really take the helm and be the, you know, focal point for the LWO. It wasn't like the NWO. You had Hogan, you had Nash, you had, at a later time, Sting. So there was all these figureheads involved with the NWO, but with the LWO, honestly, really, Eddie Guerrero was the only one who had kind of the, I guess, in the eyes of the fans, the prestige to be viewed as, you know, the leader of the pack, you know, this alpha of the team. And with him gone, you know, again, there wasn't really anyone who could talk on the mic like Eddie Guerrero. Chavo Guerrero had a little bit of it, but he was never really as good as Eddie Guerrero. You know, you weren't going to ask La Parka and Silver King to get on the mic, even though he was chairman of the board. But yeah, so when Eddie Guerrero came back, he started a brief feud slash partnership with Rey Mysterio once again. They helped form the Filthy Animals, which involved Kidman and Conan. But Eddie Guerrero would go back and forth. They were friends, they were enemies, they were friends, they were enemies. And his time in WCW didn't last long. Much after that, he would stay there for about almost until the end of the year. So he would come back, I believe, in like May of 99, would do a few matches, a couple of pay-per-views. But his last match was actually against Billy Kidman November 22nd, 1999. And this would lead into, obviously, Chris Benoit and Dean Malenko and Perry Saturn leaving the company towards the end of the year as well. Them showing up the day after Royal Rumble all together on that episode of Raw. And the Radicals making their debut in the WWF / WWE. So yeah, so that's basically the legend of Eddie Guerrero in WCW. You know, looking back on it, he wasn't there for a long time. October of 95, leaving until November of 97, but he definitely made an impact, and he definitely was one of the specific cases of someone who was held back, because he came in with a lot of momentum, and he was always an attraction. I mean, I remember growing up, when we talked about Nitro, yeah, you know, we talk about Goldberg sometimes, we talk about Hogan and Hall and Nash, yeah, of course. But when we weren't talking about the NWO, we were talking about the Cruiserweights, or even to a certain extent, the Horsemen. But it was always those guys, Eddie Guerrero, Rey Mysterio, and there was always glimmers of, oh, maybe these guys one day are going to be the world champion. Maybe we'll see Rey Mysterio fighting for the world heavyweight title. I mean, that time when he took on Nash was like fantastic. It blew my mind, you know. When Chris Benoit finally won the title before he exited, like, it was like just sort of, it was bittersweet, because it was like, this is what could have been. These guys could have ushered in a new era, a new generation of WCW, and who knows, maybe that could have kept them in the fight of the Monday Night War, because that was the one outlet, as exciting as WWF was at the time, With the Monday Night Wars, you know, with the Attitude Era, you had Austin running around, you had The Rock running around. They couldn't really offer the level of match quality that guys like Guerrero, Rey Mysterio, Ultimo Dragon, Dean Malenko, Chris Benoit, all those guys, Jericho, they couldn't offer that. So lucky for them, a lot of these guys got frustrated with WCW and ended up leaving anyway. Because then that's when WWE finally got that. You look at, you know, my the No Mercy Let's Play videos. That was a fantastic year. Because you had Eddie Guerrero coming in with the rest of the Radicals, Benoit, Malenko, and Saturn. You had Jericho coming in. Kurt Angle made his debut. And he was able to show how good he was in the ring because he had these great ring talents to work with. I mean, like, realistically, like, go back and watch some of those WWE pay-per-views, with the exception of Rock, Stone Cold, Triple H, Undertaker, Kane, like, you know, there really weren't any other guys that you were interested in. Like, did we really want to see Steve Blackman? Did we really want to see, you know, Draws? Like, no disrespect to those guys. They all did fine in their roles, but, you know, I think the Royal Rumble, after the Royal Rumble 2000, it was a really big turning point for that company in terms of delivering that quality product of wrestling. They had the storylines, they had the angles, they had the guys who could talk on the mic. Now they needed the wrestlers, and they got all the wrestlers that WCW had that they didn't know what to do with. And Eddie Guerrero was a prime example of that. Unfortunately, when Eddie Guerrero came into the WWE, he still had a lot of his drug issues that had plagued him, even going back to before he came into WCW. I don't know if a lot of people actually know Eddie Guerrero put him on the map was he formed a tag team with Art Barr. And Art Barr was actually the one who would do the frog splash. And they were a fantastic tag team. And it was a crazy tag team because, you know, they wore like the red, white, and blue pinstripe tights. And here was this sort of, you know, this was this Mexican wrestler, but being promoted as like this baby face. Sort of like Americana representation. Like it was interesting. It was very dynamic that they did that. Here comes Chavo Guerrero Jr. I think this is the second to last match against Chavo Guerrero Jr. Very fitting because a lot of this year that we talked about, it was his feud with Chavo Guerrero. So I think it's really cool. It's kind of coming full circle because I'll be facing Chavo Guerrero Jr. and then facing Chris Jericho, who Eddie Guerrero beat for the Cruiserweight title the first time. So very poetic in my eyes. I'm happy it worked out like that. But yeah, so Eddie Guerrero and Art Barr were a tag team for a very long time, and Art Barr actually died. He OD'd, I believe, or at least died because of complications of his drug use. He was addicted to painkillers, and Eddie Guerrero had swore off painkillers because of that, but he couldn't fight it. Again, this was a guy who wanted to make a name for himself and knew he was held back because of his nationality and his size. So he did whatever he could to get to the top. And that resulted in him being addicted to painkillers, the very thing that had killed his friend, Art Barr. And he struggled with that for a long time. He struggled with alcoholism. He struggled with some other kinds of drugs. And unfortunately, that's what caught up to him. When he came back to WWE, and even though when he came back, because he was in WWE, then he got released because of his issues, and then he came back when he got cleaned up, and that's when he began his world title run and everything like that. But unfortunately, that caught up to him. But he did the frog splash in sort of memory to Art Barr. Art Barr was the one who did it first. He wasn't the inventor of it, but it was his finishing maneuver. And then after Art Barr passed, Eddie Guerrero adopted the frog splash because of that. So a lot of neat things like that, a lot of cool stuff like that. You know, I kind of wish people still did that. You know, right now, Blake and Murphy in NXT, their finisher is sort of reminiscent of what Eddie Guerrero and Art Barr used to do. One guy would go for like the suplex setup, and then the other guy would go for a frog splash. It's kind of cool to see stuff like that kind of come back around. I love when wrestlers, you know, try to use what older, you know, other wrestlers used to do, because it always went on. You know, it's not like Eddie Guerrero invented the Black Tiger Bomb. It was called the Black Tiger Bomb, but he was Black Tiger number two. So I'm gonna actually create a Black Tiger 2 call in Virtual Pro Wrestling 2. I'm very excited about that because Eddie Guerrero, again, in his short time wrestling in New Japan, he gained a lot of success. He won one of the best of the Super Junior tournaments, and he wrestled for the IWGP Junior Heavyweight title several times. So no matter where he went, even though he was only there for a limited amount of time, it felt like, he always made quite an impact. And he definitely made an impact on me when he was in the Cruiserweight division, because him and Jericho were like the two guys, and Rey Mysterio, even though I didn't really ever truly believe that Rey Mysterio was going to be allowed to wrestle in for the World Heavyweight title. But when I used to watch Guerrero and Jericho and even Benoit, I used to think, yeah, these are the guys that are going to become world champion one day. These are the guys that are going to, I'm going to see him face Hogan. I mean, Eddie Guerrero, a lot of his early matches, you can watch him on the WWE Network in Nitro. Eddie Guerrero takes on Ric Flair a few times, and, you know, it's what could have been. And, you know, it's not like saying Eddie Guerrero didn't gain a lot of success, but it really highlights how WCW really dropped the ball on these guys. And it does make you wonder if they would have allowed these guys to do what they were so good at and be free, how different the company might have been, how different things might have worked out for everyone. And, you know, it's not to say like where we are in wrestling right now suffers because of it, but I like to think that it probably isn't still where it could be. I mean, look at something like Lucha Underground, you know, and what all those guys doing there. It reminds me of like early WCW. It reminds me of all the hybrid between the Lucha Libre style wrestling and the Japanese style wrestling, and introducing that to an American style and mixing it. And that's exactly what Eddie Guerrero and these guys did, and they did it so well, and you weren't seeing that stuff. Like, their matches, like, you look at the early Nitros when WCW brought in Eddie Guerrero, Benoit, watch every other match on that card and compare it to the Eddie Guerrero matches, and it's like night and day. You know, these guys were ahead of the curve. These guys knew what the future of wrestling was going to be. So it's really nice to see that they were right. They were right in a sense. I mean, we still got a long way to go. But if you look beyond WWE, look at what's going on in Lucha Underground, look at what Ring of Honor has been doing for so many years, look at what New Japan Pro Wrestling has been doing for so many years, because even they had a tough time transitioning from a very specific, strong style to incorporating a lot more, you know, of the high flying, of the flexibility. You know, not everyone has to be this big tough guy. Everyone struggled with that for a very long time, and Eddie Guerrero definitely was one of those people that helped say, hey, this is the future, baby, this is it, and we're gonna show you how it's done. And a lot of people, a lot of wrestlers, are, you could see their influence coming from Eddie Guerrero. So go back, watch his Cruiserweight matches, because I don't even view them as Cruiserweight matches. Like, they, yeah, 220 pound limit, this and that, but those Cruiserweight matches to me were more than just Cruiserweight matches. They were just matches. They were just great. They were fantastic, and they were sometimes, if not almost all the time, the best matches of the night. And Eddie Guerrero, you know, he goes to work in every single one of those matches, and it's great that he achieved the success that he did. And it's unfortunate that he's not around, because I still would love to see him. You know, I think about him almost all the time when I watch wrestling. Like, man, what would Eddie Guerrero be doing right now if he was wrestling? Would he be in WWE? Would he be in Lucha Underground? He'd totally be in Lucha Underground. Oh, man, he'd be the hottest thing in Lucha Underground. And honestly, this is like super fantasy booking. Like, all due respect to Alberto Del Rio. I love Alberto Del Rio. Until Rey Mysterio Jr. probably comes around in Lucha Underground Season 2, if they get to do a Season 2, if Eddie Guerrero was around, Eddie Guerrero probably would help put Lucha Underground on the map in terms of mainstream. Especially with how his career in WWE was going, you only knew it was going to get better and better and better. And then maybe when it was time for him to part ways with WWE, he probably would have went to Lucha Underground and I guarantee you more eyes would be on it if Eddie Guerrero was in Lucha Underground. You know, it's not fair to say because he's not around anymore, but, you know, I'm going to do an episode on Conan down the line because I don't think people really realize how big Conan was and still is in Mexico. He's pretty much like the Hulk Hogan over there. Like, he really is. He's one of the biggest stars of Lucha Libre wrestling in the past, you know, 20-something years. And when he came to the WCW, he never really reached those heights. And then they never even really brought him into WWE, which I always thought was a shocker. Because I felt like in WWE, he probably would have been more closer to reaching the level of success and popularity that he did in Mexico. So they would have needed a guy like that. And in Lucha Underground, Conan has that supporting role, but since he was never viewed in the eyes of the American audience like he was in Mexico, I feel like he doesn't bring that star power that Lucha Underground needs for it to be a success over here in the States. They don't really even have a TV deal to be viewed in a lot of places in the Latin Americas and South America, and they would be blowing it up if they did. So I hope in season 2 of Lucha Underground they do that. But yeah, that's just something I always think about today is like, man, if Eddie Guerrero was around, where would he be? Would he be in Lucha Underground? And that show would be off the chain if he was there. Like, I mean, it's already off the chain. If you're not watching Lucha Underground, watch it. First season is almost wrapping up. They got their special in August, you know, closing, you know, their season finale, basically. And hopefully they get season 2. But yeah, man, I think about Eddie Guerrero, man. I think about Eddie Guerrero every day. Like I knew him, even though I never met the dude. I've unfortunately never seen him wrestle live, but I've watched many of his matches, and one of my favorite wrestlers of all time. And here we go, this match is about to be over soon. Chris Jericho and Eddie Guerrero. So if you've been watching, paying attention all playthrough, I'm sorry if I haven't been talking about the gameplay. There's just so much to talk about with Eddie Guerrero. But again, this was one of my previous playthroughs, so, you know, I didn't want to kind of be a little repetitive about it. And also, I don't want every episode to just me be calling out the spots and what's going on. I'll chime in here or there, but, you know, we all know how these games play. And I think it's very interesting to watch the matches along with hearing, you know, maybe some of the backstory and context. I hope you guys appreciate that. But so basically, this is the last match. So this match, I have to win with the Frog Splash, right? That's the goal. That's the goal. I want to win with the Frog Splash. Jericho is now putting up a fight. He's got his comeback special. It's going to be very difficult. Very difficult. I love that Eddie Guerrero has that counter. I love when anyone has that counter in Revenge because it might seem a little cheesy, but it helps out in Revenge a lot because look at Jericho's special. It's climbing up there. He's got the comeback special. So when you have an arm striking counter like that, that goes automatically into a move, it really helps to slow down the momentum. Because if it was just a regular strike, the computer would almost most definitely counter it right back. And then unfortunately, sometimes you'll be facing a computer who has that counter arm striking into a move, and they could just keep raising their special up. So I love that Eddie Guerrero does the little eye poke. Slows down Jericho's momentum. But here we go. I'm trying to bring my special meter up. Give him the foot rake. Doesn't raise my special meter, which I think is interesting. There's a few moves that I've been noticing while I've been replaying these games that actually don't raise your meter. It's very interesting, like, how, I wouldn't say broken, just how incomplete these games kind of feel, especially when you see how they were able to improve on them and perfect them. But it's like little things like that. It's like, it makes you wonder how they went about designing the damage and how things affect meters. Like, did it really have to be on a move-by-move basis? Because there's a lot of times where, you know, like just a few moments ago where I did that eye rake, and usually any head submission move that isn't a submission, that's just some sort of move, the meter goes up. But here the meter doesn't. Like if you do like the bottom leg move where you do like the handstand on the guy's leg and then bring your knees down, that raises your meter. So it's very interesting when a move like the eye rake doesn't raise your meter. Here we go. Chris Jericho's got a special going. I gotta be very careful here because I don't want him to pull off his special. Don't want him to get the lion tamer on me, because even though he's got the comeback special, even if he didn't, if he got that lion tamer on me, his meter would go up automatically, because the lion tamer is one of the few moves in the game where, or few submission moves in the game, I should say, where your meter goes up automatically even without a comeback special. It's kind of cheesy, but it's how I win all my Jericho matches. So, again, it's just a game. WCW and NWO Revenge is a beautiful game in that way, is that, you know, it's one of those classic older games where you can definitely exploit the inconsistencies. And there we go with the frog splash. Oh, almost got it. Two pin. That could have put him away. I don't know why it didn't. Give him another brain buster. You know what? I'm going to take this opportunity to go for the frog splash again. Boom. Here we go. Oh, this is great. Our meters are at the places they want to be. Three count fall. Frog splash. Eddie Guerrero. Great way to end the championship run. Love it. Let's watch it again. Oh, man. It's always great when it works out this way. Like, you don't really plan it, but you got to take those opportunities. And again, to set up people in position for flying moves are a little bit trickier in this game, because the computer doesn't stay down long enough and it's harder to move them around the ring. But here we go. Frog splash, brain buster followed by the five star frog splash. That's RVD. It's a whole nother let's play. But followed by the frog splash, here we go. Your new Cruiserweight champion, your first WCW NWO Revenge let's play Cruiserweight champion. I hope you liked the information, all the facts, all the little trivia, my own little opinions and ideas and theories and reflections about Eddie Guerrero, one of my favorite wrestlers of all time. If you like the video, please give me a like, subscribe so when you know my next video is coming in. I'm trying to, going forward, one video a week for now, so that I have a nice backlog I can keep coming back to and put them up. But there we go, Eddie Guerrero. Please leave comments. I hope you enjoyed the video. Watch those Eddie Guerrero Rey Mysterio matches. Keep watching wrestling, and I'll see you next time. Thank you. Bye-bye.